Simon & Schuster Audio presents Camera Girl, The Coming of Age of Jackie Bouvier Kennedy by Carl Sferrazza Anthony, read by Imani Jade Powers.
Dedicated to my friends, Peter McManus and John McGuire, for joyous companionship in the pool of knowledge as I wrote this book through the pandemic. My parents, whose unrelenting confidence propelled the book from the start. Author's note. Unless otherwise indicated, all dollar figures have been translated into today's dollars. People often forget that I was Jacqueline Bouvier before being Mrs. Kennedy or Mrs. Onassis. Throughout my life, I have tried to remain true to myself. Jacqueline Lee Bouvier Kennedy Onassis, in a 1972 interview. Part 1. Eastern Seaboard. Read, then think. Listen, then think. Watch, then think. Think, then speak. Jackie's advice to her friend Vivi Crespi. 1. Getting her camera. May to August 1949. As the June 1949 wedding season approached, it seemed like every one of her fellow social register debutantes wanted a husband. All Jacqueline Bouvier wanted was a terrific camera. Vassar College had only just begun its final exam period, but the sophomore in slim skirts, who wore her long tawny hair straightened to drape over one of her luminous hazel eyes, was eager to complete her second year and leave the Hudson River Valley campus behind. Among her innumerable and pronounced contradictions, Jackie was an excellent student who hated school. She credited individual instructors for introducing her to subjects that became lifelong passions, but learned more on her own, outside institutional boundaries. She lived for socializing every possible weekend. She indulged her expensive tastes until told to stop. She flirted her way into the heart of any beau she wanted, yet she was intellectually ambitious. Her boarding school headmaster, Ward Johnson, in an unpublished letter to Jackie's mother's friend, Molly Thayer, who wrote the first biography of Jackie, noted that her college board examinations, taken as a high school senior, really proved the sort of mind she has. Of 26,000 examinations, only 22 ranked in the 0.1%, and Jacqueline Bouvier's was one of these. However, she also accepted the era's belief that young women should hide their intellectual gifts. Attesting to her brilliant work, Johnson noticed that to avoid doing too well, she would deliberately leave out one question on a test. In the weeks before she finished the Vassar semester, she had dashed down to the annual formal Mrs. Shippen's dancing class ball in Washington and the Virginia Gold Cup horse race in Warrenton, Virginia. But, swamped with work, she then disciplined herself to study till exams are over. Yet again, she made the honor roll. On the day her sophomore year ended, June 9th, she departed the campus immediately with all she owned. Her destination was Marywood, her mother and stepfather's McLean, Virginia estate. This was a trip she knew well, taking her through New York City, where she'd make her way cross town from Grand Central Station to Pennsylvania Station to catch the train to Washington. On the way, she would typically stop in at that camera store by the station, almost certainly Peerless Camera, located at 138 East 44th Street, which was walking distance from Grand Central, and famously offered photographers the full spectrum of new cameras and cutting-edge equipment of seemingly all makes and models, and an array of attachments from lenses to flashes. The object of her desire was the Leica 2C, notable for its fast shutter speeds, which had gone into production the previous year. Inevitably, she asked the exasperated clerks the same question she had the last time she had stopped in. Had the Leica 2C price come down yet? The answer was always the same. No, it had not, and would not. She persisted in asking, nonetheless, as if by sheer force of will, she could reduce the cost of that camera. She wanted the best camera to record her imminent year abroad in Paris. In the summer of 1948, Jackie had taken her first trip to Europe. With her friend Helen Beau Bowden, Beau's younger sister Judy, and Julia Bissell, another friend, she'd set sail on the legendary Queen Mary for the voyage across the Atlantic to see the European nations that lived vividly in her imagination after years of reading the literature of the continent. Beau remembered of their crossing that 19-year-old Jackie liked her martinis and had a few on the boat, and that a black bug got down her dress. Beau's stepfather, Edward H. Foley, who was a Treasury Undersecretary under President Truman, had pulled strings to secure the girls tickets to a garden party at Buckingham Palace. Being greeted by King George VI and Queen Elizabeth in a receiving line beneath a tent in a rainstorm was, Jackie gasped to Beau, the most exciting moment of my life. They twice shook hands with Winston Churchill. For 7 weeks, the foursome toured England, Italy, Switzerland, and France, chaperoned by Jackie and Beau's high school Latin teacher, whom Jackie planned to lock in a closet at night so they could go to a nightclub in Paris. Her wish came true when her stepbrother and confidant, Hugh Yusha Auchincloss, arrived in town and took her out. Upon her return to the United States, Jackie began searching for a way to spend her junior year studying in Paris. Vassar didn't offer any such program, but she fatefully spotted a hallway bulletin board flyer about Smith College's program at the Sorbonne. Non-Smith applicants were rare, and her enrollment was not guaranteed. She applied in January 1949, taking 2 extra courses in French language and literature in order to improve her French and demonstrate her commitment. Initially, Smith approved her only for study in London, but after agreeing to first take an intensive 6-week language course at the University of Grenoble, she was finally granted the Paris option. In her own words, she finagled into the program. Her dilemma was that she had to get that Leica in hand before she left the United States for Europe in August, a month after her 20th birthday. Getting it as a birthday present seemed like the most realistic way to acquire it in time for her transatlantic crossing. It so happened, though, that one of the very few things John Vernoux Blackjack Bouvier III and his ex-wife, Janet Auchincloss, could agree on was that this birthday present Jackie was so set on was too great an extravagance. In June 1949, the Leica 2C was retailing for $185, $2,100 today. She had assured her parents that she'd considered several options, boring them with the technical details regarding the capacity of one camera type versus another. The Leica 2C, she authoritatively explained, would be ideal for both black and white outdoor photos and color slides of artwork taken in the museums she would soon be visiting in Paris. Plus, the sturdy Leica would fit into her handbag, or she could wear it around her neck on a leather strap. They'd both think about it, her parents told her. There was still time. Once school was out, she'd first see her mother at home in McLean, join Daddy for 2 weeks of vacation with his family in East Hampton, and then visit her mother and stepfather at their Newport, Rhode Island summer estate, Hammersmith Farm, before leaving for France. Reviewing all this for Yusha, she conceded it would take a real effort to get the little Leica from either parent. But Jackie Bouvier thrived on challenge. Jackie had met Yusha, tall, gaunt, and shy, at Marywood when she was 12 and he was 14, just days after the Japanese had bombed Pearl Harbor and the United States entered World War II. Mummy was then dating Hugh D. Auchincloss, Yusha's father, and the two Auchincloss men retrieved Jackie, her sister Caroline, who was called by her middle name Lee, and Mummy from Washington's Union Station, already thick with members of the armed forces. Yusha's first impression was of Jackie's concern for the men in uniform and knowledge of current events, With her French heritage, she was interested in what would become of France now that America was at last in the war. Although Jackie had dreams of glory at too early an age to be of service, it was clear to him that she wanted a life that left an impact. After dinner, their parents tried to teach them gin rummy. Neither Yusha nor Jackie was interested. The pair had permanently bonded when, in the course of his showing her the local sights, they had discovered their mutual passion for history. She read aloud the words of Lincoln engraved on the wall of his memorial. In the Smithsonian, she fixated on exhibits about Native American tribes and the First Ladies. Staring at the White House, closed due to wartime restrictions, she wondered how the Roosevelts must now feel after Pearl Harbor. At Arlington National Cemetery, she wondered how many more graves would be there by the war's end. 6 months later, in June 1942, the modest exchange of marital vows between his twice-divorced father and her once-divorced mother made them family. The intense, enduring connection Jackie and Yusha formed carried over into frequent correspondences when they both attended boarding school and lived away from home. Together, they could endlessly ponder topics from war news.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.